Thank you for those of you who are here, and thank you to those of you who are tuned in via the web or video. I appreciate the opportunity to kind of sit down and talk about all this Ebola stuff. As you know, it is certainly a point of concern around our country, around our state and community. You all know that we have very special capabilities, special expertise here, which essentially is certainly unsurpassed when you look around the country and around the globe. And because of that, to no one's surprise, we're being asked to share that expertise, certainly with the people of Texas, and to the extent that it's possible and we can, the people of the country and the people of the world. And that's what we're supposed to do. That's our mission, to improve health for the people of Texas and people around the world. So I just have some stuff that I want to go through, if you'll bear with me. I chose not to use slides today. I really wanted this to be more conversational in tone. I won't spend a lot of time going through the material. I want to have plenty of time for questions. And as we respond to questions, I'm going to call on, if it's appropriate, a number of our experts who are here so they can provide you with more detailed knowledge in a response. So a couple of things, or a few things I think are interesting or informative. Zero, let's talk about some numbers. Zero is the number of Ebola-infected patients we are currently treating at UTMB. Three is the number of isolation rooms we are prepared to open in the event that we must take care of a patient or patients who have contracted Ebola. 32 is the number of nurses who have been trained and who have stepped up, volunteered for service in the event that an Ebola-infected patient presents here. That deserves applause, I know. Zero is the number of students who will be working with an Ebola patient if one presents here at UTMB. Same for residents. We're not going to have students or trainees involved in the care of Ebola patients. Now, that said, it's very important to train our students how to recognize a patient who may be at risk for Ebola infection, because it is certainly likely over the coming years it's going to be necessary to know how to take an adequate history and how to assess risk. So we are going to train our students and residents, but we're not going to ask them to be directly involved in care if that need arises. 7,000 is the number of people UTMB's national lab has trained through the National Biosafety Training Center to handle biosafety level 3 and 4 agents, emerging infectious diseases. Those 7,000, over 7,000 people, I think it's closer to 7,700, have come from more than 100 countries around the world and from other agencies such as NASA and branches of the military. 10 is the number of years that UTMB has been incinerating medical waste safely and effectively. We process 1,500 pounds of medical waste per day at UTMB. 1,500 and 1,800 degrees Fahrenheit are the temperatures in our incinerator. What survives at 1,500 degrees? Absolutely nothing. Ash comes out, there's nothing viable in ash. 1,800 degrees actually is the temperature of the second chamber, which accepts any particulate matter which rises up from the ash and it vaporizes it. So the byproducts are gases and heavy metals, which have been superheated. The heavy metals are precipitated out, condensed into a pellet. The material is taken to a landfill. Again, no chance for viability of anything at those temperatures. This is my favorite one. 11,900 is the number of competent, dedicated, and skilled UTMB employees who give them of themselves day in and day out to care for the sick, to find cures for diseases, and to train the healthcare workforce of tomorrow. Now, just some information. You know, we've been visited by several state agencies, leaders of state agencies. One of our own, an alum, Dr. Kyle Janik, is the executive commissioner for the Texas Health and Human Services Commission. Commissioner Janik was here earlier this week. He's traveling around to major hospitals around the country. He wanted to be reminded of our abilities associated with the national lab, and also to understand what capabilities we have today or we might have in the future to care not only for patients who might have Ebola, but any other highly infectious, highly transmissible disease. So we took him through that. Ms. Allenberger put together, with the help of the healthcare leadership team, some information relative to preparedness, particularly for Ebola. So let me just share that with you. So the people, or the services, the programs involved in preparing this information: infectious disease, epidemiology, experts from the Galveston National Lab, including our biosafety and environmental safety experts, Department of Pathology, Pulmonary Critical Care Division, the nursing group within the health system, police, our marketing communications people, and of course, executive and senior leaders from the health system administration. So progress to date. So the leadership group is consulted with faculty and staff at existing biocontainment patient care units around the country. What are those? We've read about them. These are where the patients have been cared for. Nebraska, Emory, Missoula, Montana, and now the NIH, okay? And because of the nature of the work done in our lab here, we have networks with experts who are involved in actually caring for patients at each of those sites. The leader of the unit at Nebraska is actually one of our alums, a former ID fellow. So we've learned a lot from their experiences. We continue to stay in touch with them, listen to them about the things they've encountered as barriers, how they've overcome those, and incorporated their learnings into our procedures and policies and protocols here. Conducted a number of scenario planning exercises for a variety of patient care locations. As you heard earlier, identified staff and faculty volunteers. Trained our emergency department triage and clinic staff to identify potential patients. Developed the Epic EMR advisory and workflow, and many of you who are engaged in patient care have seen that and are using it. Developed a transportation plan for patients who present at a clinic, an urgent care site, the Angleton-Danbury campus, or even in the community. We've worked with the EMS in Galveston and also the Windsor EMS group, which provides service in Brazoria County to Angleton-Danbury, to develop transportation protocols to transfer patients who we think could possibly have been exposed or might have Ebola disease. We certainly have identified and ordered additional supplies and equipment and continue to do that. Dr. La Posada has developed a plan for handling of laboratory specimens and testing, and we can go into details about how this works in a little bit. Developed overarching protocols and procedures relative to just managing patient flow, specimen flow, waste flow, and the like, and continue our efforts to communicate what's been done, what training's been performed, put out our training schedules for the near future so people know when they will be trained if they could possibly be involved in some way. Among the additional supplies that are ordered, the personal protective equipment, which really is the frontline barrier that protects patients as well as providers, the clean guard suits, impervious gowns, puncture-resistant gloves, goggles, face shields, the isopod negative pressure individual containment system. This is essentially a stretcher. We have one already. I believe we've ordered a second one, which is covered by an impervious plastic shield. The way the airflow works, it creates a negative pressure environment for transport of a patient. Chemical toilet, of course, that's necessary to have where the patient is to process much of the waste. iStat lab testing equipment. Dr. La Posada is arranging for us to get the equipment. Some of it is on order and will be here, I think, Monday, Dr. La Posada. to arrive so we can do just about every laboratory test we'd want on site in the unit where we'd have patients, so we wouldn't have to transport laboratory specimens to the lab. We've heard that's a huge issue in the places that have cared for a patient. I think the first patient was cared for, Dr. Lee, at Emory, and this became an immediate issue. They actually had a courier service that delivered laboratory specimens that refused to do that. So we had individuals who were driving specimens down the street from Emory to CDC. Obviously, that's not ideal. So again, now we know how to do appropriate laboratory testing and do it at the site, so we don't have to worry about moving specimens over space or involving people that don't need to be involved. Lab testing equipment includes a CBC analyzer, D-dimer testing capabilities, others. Protocol overview. Patients are screened according to protocol. You all know that. The patients who need to be are immediately isolated in an emergency department or a clinic or in a community case if necessary. The nursing personnel begin a list of all staff and supervisors who have encountered the patient. We notify infectious disease and epidemiology services here. They become immediately involved, and in some cases, many cases, will actually go to the site to oversee the management of the patient and preparations for transport back to UTMB. And of course, we notify state and county officials immediately. So if a patient is admitted or transferred by EMS, placed into the isopod, the piece of equipment that I described earlier, if that's not available, the clean guard suit. Did any of you see the pictures in this morning's papers of one of the nurses being moved from Dallas to either Emory or, well, you saw she was in a clean guard suit, essentially. So it's that same sort of transport system. Begin our patient care protocols or treatment protocols, and certainly only involve those people who have been adequately trained in the donning and doffing of personal protective equipment. And that appears to be the critical step. The hypothesis relative to the infection of the Dallas health workers is that the protocols really weren't adequate. The use of the PPE wasn't adequate. Now, the CDC is following up on that, so is the State Department of Health Services. But we know, particularly based on the West African experience, Dr. Kaizak talked about this in his talk a couple of weeks ago, that is absolutely critical. And so we have very stringent protocols for the use of personal protective equipment. Essentially, the way the patient care would go, as I understand it, is two nurses would be assigned to each patient, the way this is being done at Emory and Missoula and University of Nebraska, now NIH. One nurse actually delivers the care, the other is the monitor in the room. Nobody else other than selected physicians, either a critical care physician or an infectious disease specialist, would be allowed in the room. The nurses would trade off over the course of a shift, one being the monitor, one being the care deliverer, and nobody else would be allowed in the room. All of the environmental support functions, delivery of food, those sorts of things, would come from those identified volunteer trained workers who've demonstrated that they can adequately use the PPE. The doffing procedure, the removal, is so important. So there's actually a monitor who's trained, who has a written protocol, who, when the doffing process begins, makes sure that the people removing their personal protective equipment follow every step. Some of you have seen how our researchers work in the national lab. I've always been impressed. They never move quickly. They move very deliberately. They do it the same way every time. They use the highest level of precaution. They don't leave anything to chance. So what our biosafety trainers have told us, that's absolutely critical. Translating that approach that's allowed us to safely use, study these very infectious agents, Ebola and many others, over 10 years, is translated into these clinical protocols. And that's what protects us, allows us to provide very safe care to an infected patient. So everything that's built into our protocols is based on a translation of what has worked so well for us in dealing with these agents over the past 10 years. Medical waste, everything's placed into a drum in the room. It is taken to an incinerator, all the lab work's done on site. I mentioned that earlier. Food is delivered on disposable trays. Essentially, everything that goes into the room is disposable. Patients are monitored with a video monitor. If you talk to the people at Nebraska and Missoula and Emory, the medical consultations that were necessary were actually offered through a video link. So there's actually video cameras on the patient. The medical record, of course, is available in Epic outside the room. And the caregivers in the room can facilitate the gathering of any information the consultant needs. That recommendation is entered into the chart. The consultant never enters the room. So, and of course, you know, for patients in this particular sort of high containment space, there's not a lot for them to do. So the other thing we're thinking about is iPads, other things that would be temporary, they'd be there, but things that would allow them to have some diversion of their time so they wouldn't absolutely go stir crazy. So again, you can see this is not certainly everything in the protocols, but our people have been working very diligently to think about if we encountered one of these patients in our system, how we would deal with them. Now, the only thing that we currently have really been asked to do is to incinerate the medical waste associated with the care for of Mr. Duncan, the patient who was cared for at Presbyterian Hospital in Dallas. That waste is still there. We were contacted by the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality a little over a week ago. And their first question is, do you have a capacity and a capability to safely deal with this sort of waste? It's contained in a 55-gallon drum, which is a big container. It's been sealed, it's been treated, the material in it's been treated according to the CDC protocols for disinfection, but the size of the container makes it problematic. And so we looked at what they were asking, we talked to the CDC, State Department of Health Services, got very involved in terms of looking at how the material was managed, with our biosafety people, environmental health and safety people, and determined that it was appropriately managed. It's been appropriately disinfected. Our scientists believe that there's zero possibility of infection associated with the packaging of this waste. It's currently safe. It's been placed in a refrigerated truck that still is in Dallas. It's been packed according to a Department of Transportation policy specifically developed for this purpose. And the U.S. Department of Transportation has licensed it for transport, also made sure that the packing system that's being used doesn't allow those drums to move around or be damaged in transit. So we received an official request to render aid. This is coming from one state agency to another earlier this week from the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. As it turns out, we're the only facility in the state of Texas licensed and capable of safely incinerating medical waste that's contained as this waste is. So we are going to do that. It's hard for us as a state agency to say no to a request for aid when we know that we can provide that. We feel we can do this safely, and from my personal perspective, where else in the country can this be done any more safely than here? You heard me mention before that we process 1,500 pounds a day. Our people are comfortable with this. We're going to take all appropriate safety precautions. And so this is a responsibility that we basically have to secure health for the people of Texas, is to help the state dispose of this material. The likelihood of it containing any viable infection, even on the inside right now, is extremely low, according to our scientists, because of the amount of time, the nature of the waste. It's mostly personal protective equipment that was used. Any small amount of fluid that might have been there is desiccated by now. It's unlikely the virus could survive. Essentially, the material was bagged, closed, sprayed with a disinfectant to which Ebola is known to be sensitive, placed in another, and you've seen, those of you who provide healthcare have seen these biosafety bags around our hospital, placed in another bag, closed again, disinfected again, then moved to the 55-gallon drum with an impervious biosafety liner, closed again, disinfected, and the drum has been sealed. So the last sealing, if you will, occurred outside the room, away from the patient. So a little opportunity for it to have ever encountered any of the bodily fluids that might contain virus. So anyway, we're making the final arrangements, the business arrangements to accept that material and transport. The responsibility for transport is not ours. That belongs to Dallas Presbyterian and to Stericycle, who is their vendor for disposal of solid waste. It will be brought here. Our biosafety and environmental safety experts will be there when the truck is opened. They will inspect each of the 100 or so drums that are there, determine the level of biosafety precaution we need to use. If there is an open drum or one that's been violated in any way, and again, we don't have any reason to suspect that, they have the expertise, the capability, the tools to secure that drum and dispose of it appropriately. So again, we don't expect that to be the case. They'll modify our approach based on what they find. They will superficially disinfect every one of those drums again, and then the process will begin to load them onto dollies. Our loading dock is where our incinerator is located. So essentially, those drums will be taken off the truck on a dolly, taken over about 20 feet to a lift that goes up to the incinerator opening. The dolly then is moved over. There is a carrier into which the drum is placed. It actually lifts up. It's protected so something can't fall off of it. It puts the drum into the incinerator. A top closes over it. A ram is there which pushes that drum into the incinerator. It immediately encounters the 1500 degrees and is immediately incinerated at that temperature. So I just wanted to explain that. That's really the principal reason to talk to everybody today, also for the press conference later, because we've had questions about that disposal of medical waste. Is it safe? Why did the people over in Louisiana close their borders to transport of the ash that was coming out of an incinerator? I have a lot of friends in Louisiana. I have relatives there. If Martha Levonik is here, I'm very sorry. You know, we make rational decisions in Texas, so. Seriously, you know, I'm just teasing my friends and colleagues in Louisiana. There's a, and you all know this, there's a huge level of hysteria out there now that's based in misinformation, a lack of understanding. And that's human nature. We understand that. But one of the principal responsibilities that we have as healthcare workers or as an institution of healthcare professionals focused on education and improving health for the people we serve is to provide that education. Talk about capabilities, talk about the science, what it really means, what is being done, what can be done to control this infection. What's the, or the possibility of infection, what's the likelihood that any one of us is going to encounter a patient who's infected with Ebola today? Almost zero. How many patients have we had in this country? How many people do we have in the population in the country? All right, everybody look for a high school student. Pretty low risk. Well, what about this other stuff that's out there? Middle Eastern respiratory syndrome, enterovirus, the kids now who are developing respiratory disease with symptoms of paralysis. Those are scary public health issues and pose, I think, a bigger risk right now than Ebola. But Ebola is something that really has never been in this country. We've never seen such an incredible outbreak in Africa. Certainly could, particularly with globalization of travel, result in a world health crisis in the future. So again, we need to be doing everything we can today to help people understand what this disease is, help our politicians and leaders understand what constitutes adequate efforts at control and what constitutes hysterical efforts at control that are unlikely to be successful and may actually worsen the problem. And so that's a primary focus right now. But I think it's also important for me to sit with all of you, make sure that we are communicating well among ourselves, understand our role, our capabilities, our level of preparedness, and how we're going to do everything we can to execute our mission responsibility, improve health for the people in Texas, and that includes helping Texas deal with this threat and other public health threats that are out there. So let me just stop right there. Again, that's what I wanted to say. I apologize for reading some of the remarks, but I want to make sure that I quoted some of our experts and some of our great work appropriately and see what questions you have. Now, one of the things that I want to do, please, and we'll see if we can help with this, because we have so many people tuned in, would you please try to get to a microphone so the people who are out there, and do we have a microphone we can bring around, Raymond, or somebody for people who aren't close to a microphone, so people can hear the questions who are out there tuned in?
Thank you. My question is actually, you alluded to it and then you stopped short. I was waiting. What would your current recommendations be to our presidential administration on how to better contain this disease worldwide?
Yeah, thank you. Dr. LeDuc and I were just talking about this before I came over. You know, the opinion of Dr. Kaizak, others who have been on the ground with previous outbreaks, have been there for this one, people who have been involved in World Health Organization, CDC efforts around the globe to control infectious disease outbreaks, continue to tell me that what's really important is to know where the disease is, to have adequate screening measures. Dr. Kaizak made a, and I may quote this wrong, so straighten me out. He never fails to do that, by the way. He said, you know, if you build a 20-foot fence, somebody's going to build a 22-foot ladder and go over it. And so travel bans, quarantines, isolation tend not to work on a large scale. In fact, a travel ban in particular can make it harder to understand where people have been, what their exposure might have been, and also to track, essentially, their history and understand what their risk is. So what I'm hearing from our experts is what we really need to do is look at screening. We need to ramp up screening at points of entry in the country. We need to make sure that people who are coming who might have that travel exposure that puts them at risk are willing to tell us about it. One of the things that happened with Mr. Duncan is he misled people. He didn't adequately describe his risk because he was fearful. And so if we have a travel ban, people are fearful, they can get around a travel ban just by changing their itinerary. They come into the country, they know we have a travel ban, they know they might be excluded because of that travel ban, they won't tell us the truth, and then we have no good way of tracking them, screening them, and suddenly they present with disease, and it's a much bigger problem. So right now, it's all about screening, tracking, and then doing everything we can, and I'll rely on Dr. Duke and Dr. Kaizak to talk more about this, doing what we can to help stem that outbreak in Africa, because it really is going to take a global effort to mobilize enough resources to try to turn that around. Guys, do you want to make a comment? Jim or Tom?
No, I think that's exactly right. It takes more resources on the ground and international cooperative effort. I think our country is doing their part and others are also contributing. It's going to take a lot of effort.
Yeah, thank you, Tom. Now, one of the things I did hear, I didn't get to listen to the governor's press conference earlier today, but said he's in favor of a travel ban, in favor. But he qualified that by saying, but I need to listen to our scientific experts who can tell me whether or not that truly is adequate. At least that's what I'm told. So, you know, there's a political side of this too, and I think we all understand that. Of course, what we're rooted in is the science. And so any advice that we give is going to be based on what we know about the disease, about its modes of spread, what's worked in the past and what hasn't. So thank you. Other questions? One over here.
Yes, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry. We have one over here first. What happened to the microphone? I'll get right back to you. I promise. Sorry.
We have a poison control center in emergency room? Do we have any plans to have a infectious disease colon center so people can get information what most important, what not to do?
What we're doing right now, you know, part of our access center function in Anne O'Connell, are you here? There you are. Okay, great. So one of the things that we do with that access center function is provide information. Anybody can call in to the access center and ask a question about any medical condition for advice. We triage that question. Well, let me get Ann to explain how that works.
Great job. Yes, so we triage that question, and then it's our job, if it's one of our patients, to make sure that we take care of their medical needs, get them the appointment that they want, allay their concerns. If that call needs to go elsewhere, if it needs to go to the poison center, or a nurse needs to stay on the line until we can connect them with like an appropriate resource like the poison center, we stay right there on the line with that patient. So the access center provides, you know, not just medical advice, but they also connect our patients to the right resources. Today, for example, the access center is getting quite a few calls from upset patients who don't understand how to think about Ebola. They're also reading the paper, watching the news. We also are getting calls in the access center from just concerned citizens who are trying to get to information. And Pep Valdez, I think, is here. He's developing a website that's going to be very robust and will provide a way for us to connect the non-patients, just the concerned citizens, to the most up-to-date information that we have at UTMB. So, not sure I answered your question fully. Did I hit it to your satisfaction?
Tracing whether this person was traveling, where he can be coming from. So it's basically to find out whether this person possibly could get exposed or not, whether it's common flu.
Thank you for clarifying that I didn't answer your question. We have a really robust screening system in place, and at every point of entry into the UTMB system, both by phone, in person, just as a patient is checking into the clinic or calling the access center, our electronic medical record, Epic, has a pop-up screen with all of these screening questions. And, sir, those screening questions also cover all of those West Africa locations. And so we are asking those specific questions of each and every patient at every entry point. Will we miss something? I hope not. I think we've done a lot of training around this. Do patients always understand why we're asking or exactly what we're asking? And that's a harder thing to get at sometimes. But we're certainly doing our best with screening. I hit it the second time? Okay. Yeah, I got it the second time. All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Ann. Yeah, a significant effort because it's so important to create a robust screening process so we can help patients and help ourselves understand their risk and take appropriate action if they're with us. So, yes, sir, I'm sorry.
Yes, sir, I have a simple one question, and it is, are we for sure, CDC or the other medical team members concerning this Ebola, are we absolutely sure that it's not airborne or respiratory?
At this point, it doesn't seem to be. Now, you have to qualify the answer to that question. Because what we know is that bodily fluids contain the virus. And it only takes a small amount of virus to create an opportunity for infection. And so if a patient has a runny nose, rhinorrhea. And oftentimes, patients who are in an advanced state of disease have rhinorrhea. They're vomiting. They have diarrhea. It can be explosive. They're putting out 5 to 10 liters of fluid a day. So bodily fluids can become airborne. It's not the virus itself that's airborne and moving through the air and becomes a source of infection. But one of the reasons we have those tight-fitting M95 masks in our protocols is so that if a bodily fluid is coughed or expelled in a very forceful way and is flying around in the air, it can't get to a mucous membrane. So eyes are covered, face is completely covered and sealed so that an airborne bodily fluid is not going to get around the personal protective equipment, okay? So is that a reasonable explanation? Okay.
One more question.
Yes, sir.
About those...
Wait a minute, you said just one.
I'm sorry.
Please.
Okay. Have UTMB been asked about the... two supposed patients on Magic Cruise, are we all going to be accepting those?
We're aware of those patients. You know, they're being tracked right now by the CDC. And this gets back to the CDC approach, the recommendations to each state. The state departments of health are there, basically a similar function in each state. Identify centers of excellence within each state that have the capability, particularly over time, to care adequately for patients, not only with Ebola, but some other highly infectious disease. So right now, we'd really leave that up to the State Department of Health Services, to decide how that patient would be managed. So if the cruise line comes back into Galveston, one of the scenarios I could think about is they may want to borrow our isopod and transport that patient to an aircraft and then transport that patient to one of the other facilities. Nobody's asked us right now to be prepared to accept that patient. Now, should we be? Sure. And that's the reason we've gone to all these sorts of precautions. What if just out of the blue a patient comes off a cruise ship, I'm not feeling well, comes to our ER, has a fever, and has the travel history, then our protocols go into place.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Other questions?
Do we know how long the virus lives in the body fluid that's been expelled from a patient?
Dr. Weaver, you want to answer that? Oh, he's going, why did you call on me?
It depends on the conditions, but in general, in a liquid form at room temperature, these viruses would survive perhaps a few days. These materials coming from Dallas have been in these containers for more than a week now, so we think it's extremely unlikely that they would still contain live infectious virus at this point.
Thank you. Can one of you guys also talk about what kills the virus? I mean, obviously incineration to 1,500 degrees is going to kill it, but what are the other control measures? Like, Dr. Kaizek, what in Africa, what were the kind of standards, if you will?
Well, in Africa, they use hypochlorite or bleach as the primary disinfectant. I think I said this when I gave the talk, that any time you go near one of these hospitals, you can smell them from hundreds of meters away. There's so much hypochlorite. But the viruses are enveloped, and a variety of disinfectants are actually effective. Even soap and water breaks down the envelope of the virus, and when that happens, it becomes non-infectious. For instance, in the GNL, we do use a disinfectant that has been tested and shown to inactivate it in a very short time, a matter of minutes, and then, for instance, the people who come out of the laboratory are subjected to a shower that's longer than that contact time, as an example of how that's handled. So it's easy to clean up areas in which there may have been some of the virus spilled around by a patient.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for the question. Other questions?
Uh, Are the isolation rooms going to be in the main hospital, John Cedar, or is it going to be somewhere else around on campus?
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. You know, as part of the requirement, if you will, that goes along with having a national lab, we have to be prepared to deal with an occupational exposure. And so with an occupational exposure, unfortunately, we've never had any serious accident. As I mentioned, we never had an infection associated with the work in the lab for over 10 years now. But we need to be prepared. And so, and Ms. Sollenberger could comment more, or Ms. McGrew, but basically there was an isolation room on 7C in the main hospital that was identified to deal with occupational exposures. And we still hold that and are prepared to deal with that. Now, you know, what happens with an occupational exposure? Well, we know it's occurred. We understand what the agent is. We understand what sort of screening and if we need to do any sorts of therapy. Essentially, we can walk the patient over if we need to safely. They're not going to be infectious at the time of the exposure and provide whatever treatment, support, prevention that we need to do. With a patient who presents to the ER with a fever and a questionable travel history, it's an entirely different situation. And so we think to the extent we can, segregating them from our other patients is very important. So some time ago, we prepared some isolation rooms that have the air handling capacity to deal with SARS, so they have negative pressure. Those are off the ER, separated from the ER. So those are the spaces that I talked about earlier, the three rooms, if you will, that we currently have away from the main body of the hospital, away from our patients in the ER, segregated in terms of our ability to manage things going in and waste coming out. And so that would be our approach going forward. It would essentially be a separate, self-contained unit away from our other patients. And by the way, one of the things I alluded to but didn't specifically mention, I just want to be clear about this because some of our people have asked about it. We would never ask anybody who's not been trained, comfortable with the training, and who has agreed to be involved with the care of one of these patients. So, and I know we're still progressing through our training schedule. I understand there was a concern from some of the laboratory personnel in one of the labs that might process a blood specimen. Well, number one, that's unlikely because everything's planned to be done at the bedside. In the unusual event where something would come to the main lab, we only would do that in a circumstance where we planned, prepared, trained, and the like. And that training, I think, for laboratory personnel who might be asked to be involved is coming up this week. So I just want to be clear, you know, one of the concerns in Dallas has been, did you really train people? Or did you just throw PPE at them and say, good luck, you're on your own? Now, I'm not saying that's what happened, but you hear some of the accusations or perceptions that are out there. That's one that's floating around. We certainly don't want that to be the case here. So confining the contact with the patient to people who are well-trained, believe they're well-trained, who are comfortable with following the protocols, limiting the number over the course of time is the best approach. That's certainly the CDC guideline, what we've learned from Nebraska and Emory and Missoula, Montana, and so that would be our approach.
Hello.
Hi.
Being a laboratory sciences student, I'm curious about what changes we're making in the laboratory with these samples to ensure safety of the laboratory technicians.
Dr. Laposada, you want to discuss that? Thank you for the question.
Well, I'm pleased to say that there are about seven people who've already volunteered for this task. We believe that by performing the assays in a appropriately functioning hood, which we will make sure functions correctly, that the person touching the actual secretion with the viruses in it in an infected patient should be quite safe by wearing the protective equipment and working in this environment. We will be using point of care test equipment that fits inside the hood. So all of the devices that we will have to do a complete blood count, electrolytes, organ function test will all fit in this contained area. So these are the same procedures that are happening elsewhere through the country. And I believe we will be able to even respond to that extra test that might be done if a patient encounters a different clinical scenario and we have to find out something. We will be in close contact, that is the laboratory directors, with the physicians treating the patient so that we can carefully think about how to do a test that doesn't fit in the hood so that we don't expose the general lab.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions? Yes, sir. Hey, Dr. White.
Hey, Dr. Callender, I really appreciate you coming up and the way you've explained things very clearly and the careful planning that's going on. And I really think that UTMB is really, it's important for us to step up and take care of medical waste and other things that we're capable of doing. The only minor concerns I have are actually how we're educating our frontline people, because the Epic warnings went out before people were told what to do with them. And with Epic warnings also, I think we need to be very careful not to actually warn people that about things that are risk and not. Right now, in the last month, there have been no Ebola cases in Nigeria. There have been two acquired in Dallas. We're told to screen people for travel from Nigeria, but not from Dallas. That doesn't seem to make sense.
Thank you, Dr. White. Dr. White is one of our senior infectious disease specialists, and we always listen to him. Dr. Lee, Dr. Scott Lee, who's sitting down here with Dr. Kaizak, has been very much involved in the planning process as we go forward. Yeah, you know, to your point, Dr. White, one of the biggest challenges that we've had, like everybody across the country, is doing this in a sequential, timely manner. And so, you know, the PPE and some of the tools have gone out before we've gotten around with all the training. And we've thought about that, and what we've tried to make sure, to the extent that we can, is we don't put people at risk with doing that. It's better to have the screening tool out there and begin to get comfortable with it and try to use it. It's not really putting anybody at risk. And then follow up with the training. You know, particularly for us as adult learners, it's nice to have the tool in front of us and be able to work with it as we learn how to use it. Dr. Lee has emphasized to me, I'm not, maybe because I'm a surgeon, but time and time and time again, how important it is to drill. Putting on, taking off the personal protective equipment has led a lot of that, and how important it is to follow through on the training, to have consistent training standards. So certainly appreciate your advice. And now over the coming days and weeks, the training schedule is being, it's published, it's being disseminated, so people will understand what that looks like. And if we've missed groups, there's a need to do retraining. Let's get that identified. So that, again, our people who need to be at that front edge relative to screening and identification, as well as those people who might be involved in care, are most comfortable with the use of the tools that we need for them to use effectively. So thank you very much. Other questions? Yes, ma'am.
I'm curious to know the status of the research on treatment for Ebola.
Okay. Somebody want to talk about that? Dr. LeDuc?
Well, thank you for that question. We've been working on research activities for the treatment of Ebola for several years now, and we're fortunate that many of those products or candidates are now showing great promise. We have work underway for a vaccine that seems to be very promising. We have work underway for a new class of drugs that interferes with the replication of the virus. And we have work with the monoclonal antibody compounds. And all of these are showing great progress. So, and we can all take pride in that, the fact that this work has been ongoing, kind of behind the scenes for years now at the GNL, and it's coming on just in time.
Thank you. Dr. LeDuc, I'm sorry, but let me just a follow-up question to that. So where are we? You know, some of this work's gone into, certainly been through animal trials, but what's ahead in terms of actually having something that would be available for use in treatment?
So this research has been funded primarily by NIH. Some of the research has been funded by the Department of Defense. All of this is in the preclinical stage. So once a product demonstrates that it's got utility in the laboratory, then the transitions to human trials. And you've perhaps seen in the news some of the vaccine trials that NIH is supporting. So we're starting to enter into the phase of human applications of these.
So. Thank you. Okay. Yes, sir.
Just to follow up on the vaccine clinical trials, the first vaccine has been in a phase one clinical trial, which has been done concurrently in the UK, the US, and Africa. But this is just a phase one to test safety, so we have a long way to go.
Thank you. Dr. Alan Barrett is the head of the Seeley Center for Vaccine Development and was recently recognized as one of the 8 World Health Organization collaborating centers for vaccine development in the entire world. UTMB is one of 2 in this country. So Dr. Barrett, congratulations and thank you for that great work.
We hope we never see a patient here, but if we do, is the protocol including obtaining the consent from the patient for the research use of the virus coming out of those patients?
Great question. Dr. Lee actually has talked to some of our IRB, Institutional Review Board leaders, about research. You know, one of the frustrating things about previous outbreaks, and this one in particular, at least the way it's been explained to me, and again, I'll certainly stand for correction here if appropriate, is that very little material has really been gathered for research. This is the Zaire strain of the virus. We know that. Is it different from the previous outbreaks? Are there biomarkers that we could identify that might indicate that somebody's going to progress more quickly, or who's going to be more at risk for mortality than other patients? What aspects of the disease profile can we identify that might lead us towards better management, better treatments, even prevention of spread? And so certainly we, as this institution, we need to be thinking about that. And so Dr. Lee, again, if you just want to talk about some of the conversations you've had about at least being prepared to think about some of those research questions.
I've talked to Dr. Leffelholtz, and he tells me that the IRB stands ready and available to help us with whatever humanitarian needs we need. They're almost on call, and I'm sure that they would consider any type of question like the gentleman has raised as to whether or not we would, if we were doing some research protocol on a patient, that that be considered appropriately and right decisions were made in terms of what's best for the patient.
Thank you. And Dr. La Posada is one of the experts in clinical laboratory diagnosis in the country, so he's talked a little about this. Michael, do you want to make any additional comments?
We will be ready as a team to come up with an appropriate answer for a diagnostic test.
Great. Thank you, sir. Dr. Peisler, by the way, is one of our leading experts in developing flu vaccine, so I wondered what sort of curveball he was going to throw me with that question, but that was okay. Thank you, Bobo. Yes, sir.
I read in the news that a blood from a previously infected patient with Ebola has some therapeutic stuff. I mean, if someone is infected with Ebola and he or she gets transfused a previously infected patient, that it has some therapeutic effect. So I just wanted to maybe throw more light on that.
Thank Dr. Kaizak, you want to talk about that?
Well, one of the, I guess, compassionate use experimental drugs that appears to have been quite successful is ZMAP, which are actually monoclonal antibodies that have been sort of genetically manipulated and have been used in a number of the patients, including the survivors in the U.S. The use of convalescent plasma from patients has been somewhat variable in its history. It's been used on non-human primates early in the history of the disease after it was discovered. Without success, there was an attempt to use whole blood or an actual use of whole blood during the Kikwit outbreak that led to, I think, three or four people surviving, but the numbers were low and the reliability of that outcome was questioned by many. There's a lot of discussion now about further use of convalescent blood in West Africa because there are survivors. Some of the survivors here in the U.S. and one from the U.K. have provided plasma that has been used in some of the survivors, and I guess nobody's really sure of the effects of all that. So it's certainly a matter under consideration. I think there is an attempt to make a much more regulated and studious approach to using it that WHO is setting up. That's all I have to say.
Yeah, we really just don't know yet. It's been used. The impact is not clear. But as you've heard, there are really no viable therapeutic approaches available broadly to treat patients who are infected. That's an old guard relative to some of the newer proposed therapies approach. And so it's still out there as something to be considered. But it certainly has not been shown to definitely be efficacious in treatment.
Thank you so much.
What else? We'll take one more. Yes, sir.
Is the institution going to have a policy about travel? So I'm sure we have a significant, maybe not significant, but some of our workforce that come from West Africa. Are we going to have a policy about travel to any of those endemic countries? There are five of them, but Clinton said, there's been no confirmed positive results since August 31st in Nigeria. So, but we still have Sierra Leone, Liberia, Senegal, and Guinea. Is there going to be a policy about traveling to an endemic area as a policy, one? And two, if a member of our workforce travels over there, what's the policy about them coming back to work?
This is something that's being considered at the level of the UT system. MD Anderson already has instituted such a policy. It's very understandable given their patient population. They're thinking about this from a little bit different perspective than we are. Travel bans per se, again, are really questionable. And we certainly would not want to do anything which would limit the ability of getting our expertise into West Africa where it could be applied. If national screening measures are ramped up, it really should take care of that issue for us. So at this point, at least based on what I've seen thus far, although it's being considered, I'm not really ready to institute a travel ban to those countries. I don't think that's in our best interest. I think given the knowledge of our people, the people who are likely to travel, abidance by current guidelines and future screening guidelines, that we probably cover our risk relatively well. But at this point, we're gathering scientific input and the like, and you know we'll try to make a wise decision as we go forward. But as of today, no plans to do that. Thank you. All right, thank you all very much for coming. Thank you very much for your help.